Class 10th. We will start with the revision of chapter number 14, banking. Firstly, we are going to discuss the meaning of banking. So, banking is a process or it is a technique of managing the funds or managing the money. Right? Whereas bank is an institution. Bank is an institution and banking are the services which are provided by the institution, that is bank. So a bank may be defined as a company which collects money from the public in the form of deposits and lends the same to the borrowers. Means it is a company, it is an institution, or it is an association which collects the money from the public in the form of deposits and lends the same money to the borrowers or to the people who need that money as loan. Right? Whereas banking means accepting for the purpose of lending or investment of deposits of money from the public, repayable on demand or otherwise, and withdrawal by check, draft, order or otherwise. Right? So bank is an institution and banking is the services. Simple. Correct? Now we will do only two types of bank, that is central bank and commercial bank. Right? Central bank. Now central bank in the previous class also we have done. Commercial bank also we have done in the previous class. So central bank, coming to the central bank, central bank is the apex monetary institution of our country or of any country, right? Whereas commercial bank is the bank which is treated or which can be known as an organ of the money market, right? Central bank is the apex monetary institution, means there is only one central bank in a country. There will not be 2, 3, 4, 5 central banks in a country. Whereas commercial bank can be more than 2, more than 3, or it can be many. Right. So let's come to the distinction between or difference between the central bank and commercial bank. So this is on page number 207. You please follow 207 page number of your books. Now, coming to the first point, status. So central bank's status is what? It is the apex institution of the country's monetary and banking structure. Whereas commercial bank, it is one of the organs of the money market. Second is ownership. Now, central bank is owned by the government. Government has direct control over the central bank, whereas shareholders are there in the commercial bank. Government can be there, but it can be in a hidden form. Means it can be at the back. It might work from the back, not from the front. Objective is, it is non-profit institution. Central bank is non-profit institution. Whereas commercial bank is a profit-making institution, right? Fourth, customer. Now, central bank is the banker to the government. Who is the customer of central bank? Government is the customer of central bank. Whereas, who is the customer of commercial bank? General public. Why? Because commercial banks deal with the general public, whereas central bank does not deal with the general public. Fifth is issue of notes. Now, central bank, as discussed earlier also, I have discussed it plenty of times, that central bank has the monopoly to issue note. Means central bank has the power to issue currency notes, whereas commercial bank does not have the power to issue currency notes, whereas it can only deal in currency notes. Right? Then we have is number. Every country has only one central bank, whereas there are several commercial banks in country. Now, foreign exchange. Now, it is the custodian of the country's foreign currency reserve. Means that central bank is the apex monetary institution, and being that एपेक्स मॉनेटरी इंस्टीट्यूशन, इट हैज द पावर टू इशू फॉरेन करेंसी, चेंज फॉरेन करेंसी और डील इन फॉरेन करेंसी. वेर एज कमर्शियल बैंक इट इज द डीलर इन फॉरेन करेंसी. मीन्स इट इज द परमिशन इज गिवन बाय द सेंट्रल बैंक एंड कमर्शियल बैंक प्रोवाइड्स इट. राइट, विदाउट कमर्शियल, विदाउट सेंट्रल बैंक्स परमिशन, कमर्शियल बैंक कैन नॉट गिव फॉरेन करेंसी रिजर्व टू एनी अदर कंट्री. बैंकर्स बैंक, सेंट्रल बैंक इज नोन एज द बैंकर्स बैंक. वाई? बिकॉज इट इज द हेड ऑफ ऑल द कमर्शियल बैंक्स. इट इज द बैंकर्स बैंक एज इट कीप्स देयर चेक रिजर्व्स, ग्रांट्स, फाइनेंशियल अकोमोडेशंस एंड क्लियर्स देयर बैलेंसेस. कमर्शियल बैंक इट रिसीव्स डिपॉजिट्स फ्रॉम ग्रांट्स, लोन्स टू पब्लिक. राइट, इट जस्ट रिसीव्स द डिपॉजिट फ्रॉम द जनरल पीपल एंड ग्रांट दैट डिपॉजिट इन द फॉर्म ऑफ लोन टू द जनरल पब्लिक. राइट, सो दीज आर द डिस्टिंक्शन पॉइंट्स ऑफ डिस्टिंक्शंस दैट आर इनफ. एंड वन क्वेश्चन विच माइट कम इन टू मार्क्स क्वेश्चन और विच कैन बी आज इन टू मार्क्स क्वेश्चन इज दैट डेजिग्नेशन ऑफ द चीफ एग्जीक्यूटिव. नाउ डेजिग्नेशन ऑफ द चीफ एग्जीक्यूटिव इन सेंट्रल बैंक इज गवर्नर. मीन्स द चीफ ऑफ सेंट्रल बैंक इज नोन एज गवर्नर, वेर एज द चीफ ऑफ कमर्शियल बैंक इज नोन एज द चेयरमैन. Correct. Now next we come to the functions of Central Bank or the Reserve Bank of India. You know that the RBI, Reserve Bank of India, is the Central Bank of India of our country. So it has some functions or it has some powers. Now first function is monopoly of note issue. As I have said that Central Bank has the power to issue currency note. It has the power to issue notes, whereas Commercial Bank does not enjoy this power. Right, in India only 1 rupee note is issued by the Ministry of Finance. Other than that, all the currency notes are issued by the Commercial Bank. Next is Government's Bank. Means it is the bank of the government. Why? Because government is actively present over here. Right, the Central Bank acts as a banker advisor to the government. So Central Bank is the government's bank because it acts on behalf of the government. Third is controller of credit. Not important, but still I am going to explain. Controller of credit means that it controls the credit. How? Sometimes what happens at commercial bank, they create a lot of lending money. Right? They create credits. Credits means udhar. They create credits by lending money. What happens? That too much credit is there in the economy, too much of udhar is there on the economy, which is not good for the economy. So what happens that they restrict the money or they restrict the amount of lending the money to the general public. Right, they may create too much or too less credit. The level of credit in the country causes fluctuations in the price level. It becomes necessary to exercise control over credit so as to ensure stability in the economy. So what happens that this creates problem, too much of credit creates problem in the economy, and therefore the central bank keeps a check by putting some restrictions or limitations. Right. Fourth is custodian of foreign exchange. As I have told you that central bank is the custodian of foreign exchange. Without its permission, without its yes or without its notice, we cannot, commercial bank cannot deal in foreign currency. Fifth is maintaining the exchange rate. We are not going to do this, right? Then we have is bankers bank. Now commercial bank, sorry, central bank is known as the bankers bank. Why? Because it is the head, it is the principal of all the banks. Right, the central bank acts as a banker to all the commercial banks in the country. Now, as a banker's bank, the central bank provides short-term loans and builds discounting facilities to commercial banks. It also advises the commercial banks on various matters relating to their business. Commercial banks are required to keep a certain proportion of their deposits in the form of cash reserves. As I have told you that commercial bank, they need to keep a certain portion as cash reserve with the central bank because or for emergency. Right, so therefore it is a banker's bank. Seventh is lender of the last resort. Very important and very interesting. Now lender of the last resort means that when all the commercial banks refuses to lend money to each other. Means if supposedly there is A bank and there is B bank, A bank goes to B bank, he refuses to give money to A bank. So A bank can go directly to the central bank, to the RBI, and ask for loan. Right. Now, central bank will act as a lender and therefore he will be known as lender of the last resort. Right. Clearing house function we will not do. Okay. Then developmental functions also we will not do. We will do this much only. We will do only these functions. Then let's come to financial fraudulent practices. Now, financial fraudulent practices we have done in the previous video. I'm just revising it. First is credit card fraud. You know that credit card is a broad term consisting of theft of a credit or debit card and fraudulent use of funds, right? This is growing too much in the economy, in the world actually. So we need to be very aware and we need to be very rational while we are using our credit cards or while we are using our debit cards. We should check that the ATM that we are using, that is not forged or that is not in a condition which is suspicious, right? We should check the cameras, we should check the screen, we should check the keypad. By this, we might save ourselves from credit card frauds. Second is false accounting fraud. Now, a false accounting fraud occurs when assets of a company are overstated or its liabilities are understated in order to make it appear financially stronger than what it is in reality. Right? Means we are actually fooling the accounts. If it is, it has to be 10%, we are calculating it at 15% or 20% or maybe more than that. So false accounting fraud is that we are actually forging our documents or forging the ledgers and the accounts. Then we have is insurance fraud. Now insurance fraud has existed since the start of insurance as a business activity. Insurance now is a business activity because it is mandatory. Everybody has to take insurance. Everybody has and is supposed to take insurance in some or the other manner. Vehicle insurance is definitely compulsory. If you have a vehicle, then you should have that insured. So there are diverse types of insurance, right? Now, insurance fraud is directly affected and directly affects the lives of innocent people through intentional damage and injury. Now, indirectly, these frauds lead to high insurance premiums as this is a serious problem, right? Insurance fraud is a serious problem because everyone is fooling and it's trying to fool the insurance companies by fooling themselves or declaring themselves as dead or something through which they can take the insurance, right? Then we have fourth is intellectual property fraud. Now this is a fraud involving property that is protected under the patent, trademark, copyright and trade secret laws. Intellectual property fraud consists of wide range of activities. These is fraud may involve gaining illegal access to protected material. Intellectual property fraud means that some property is being obtained by a person who is not living on that or who is not living in the country, and you by false measures you actually gain that property or you gain illegal access to that protected material. So this is intellectual property fraud. In Hindi we say kabza kar lena, right? And the last one is internet and cyber fraud, very very popular these days. This type of fraud involves a computer and a network, right? Anybody, anytime who has brain, who is a hacker, can hack and can do this fraud, right? Now, when the cyber crime occurs across international borders, it is called cyber warfare. Cyber crimes against women are done intentionally, harm women both psychologically and physically. These are the crimes which are done, right? So these were the five types of frauds that we have done. Now the remaining part I will discuss in the next video. Till then you just revise all these points, right? And I'll see you in the next video.